An Euler equation in diffy Q is going to be something that looks like this. Some kind of ax squared y double prime plus bx y prime plus c y equals 0 or whatever. Now these are kind of fun because once you recognize that you have an Euler equation, it's really easy to come up with a solution. It's just y equals c x to the r. Why, you say? Well, let's take a derivative. Y prime equals to r c x to the r minus 1. And then y double prime equals r times r minus 1, c x to the r minus 2. Isn't that lovely? Okay, so what's fantastic about this is whenever you plug these in, you get something like this. A x squared times y double prime, and then b times x times y prime, which is r, c, x, r minus 1. And then you get plus c y, which is little c, x to the r equals 0. And those c's look really stupid, but each term has one, so I can just get rid of them. There, little c's gone. Great? Awesome. Now something else you might notice is if I go and I distribute that x squared, the 2 for the x squared combines with the r to the x minus 2 to simply give me x to the r. The same thing happens again. I get br x to the r, because the coefficient up here, or the exponent there, combines with that to get back to r again. And then plus c x to the r, just like that. And now, if I assume that x r is not equal to 0, then I can divide the whole thing, or multiply the whole thing, times x to the negative r. And what's fantastic about that is that now I have ar, r minus 1, br, c equals 0, which is basically like a characteristic equation for Euler. So anytime you see anything in this form, you don't even have to make the guess anymore. You can just basically go straight from here right to here and then solve for your r's and get your answer. Now, whenever you get these r's, obviously other things can happen, so let's talk about it. Here we go. So we'll have, let's just say I solve this out and I get some kind of something or other. So I'm gonna just go to, because I don't wanna have a whole bunch of a's and b's and c's, so I'm gonna go little a's. Just say I have ar squared plus br plus c equals 0. So that's gonna distribute or end up somehow like this. And I'm gonna end up with three options, right? Because r will be negative b plus or minus b squared minus 4ac over 2a. And obviously, based on what's in the discriminant, is going to depend on what kind of answer we get. So if the thingy under the discriminant is less than 0, we're going to have two complex solutions. And they'll be in the form r is equal to some kind of alpha plus beta I. And if you've been doing diffy Q for a while, or college algebra for a while, this should start to look like something you've seen before. If the discriminant is equal to 0, that means you're going to have one real solution, but it's going to have a multiplicity of 2. So there's going to be a different kind of way that we put together the answer for that. If this here is greater than 0, then you're going to have two real solutions, no problem. And really no problem for any of them, you just have to kind of know where you're going with this. Okay, so whenever we look at the two real solutions option, this really isn't a problem at all. We would have some kind of initial constant times x, because remember our original guess was that y was equal to some kind of x to the r, something like that. So we would just have a linear combination of the two. No harm, no foul, it's all beautiful. Okay, so we're happy with that. Now the problem starts to come in is whenever we get something with the real solution that has a multiplicity of 2. Because if we had that, what we'd ultimately end up with is we would have, so what we've done in the past when we had something like this, is we had c1 plus c2x e to the x. So in the past we've had stuff that looked like this, whenever we had a multiplicity of solutions. However, that's not gonna work now, because if we have some kind of an x to the r, then these are going to combine and it's going to get all kinds of crazy. So we do need to make an adjustment. To make that adjustment, we can either do like a whole big complicated math proof, or we can kind of make an analogy. So let's pretend that instead of guessing x to the r, we actually had guessed the natural log, or sorry, e to the natural log of x to the r. So really, we would have been guessing e to the r times the natural log of x. So that's kind of weird, but our guess would have been exactly the same. Now that looks really familiar to what we would have guessed in another world. In another world, we would have done something like this. I'm going to put a little tilde to represent that this was an otherworldly kind of thing. So if I look at the exponents on my otherworldly thing, then it's kind of obvious or kind of clear or kind of something that the natural log of x in our Euler type of solution is equivalent to the x tilde of our own solution. So since in the old solution we would have had something like this, x tilde e to the r x, then what we could say is in our new solution or in our Euler equation that we would have c1 plus c2 natural log of x, e to the r ln of x, or really just the same thing of y as being c1 plus c2 ln x, x to the r, oops, ln x, x to the r. And so that's about as good as I can do of a fake proof while still maybe satisfying some basic curiosity for people who kind of want to know why we do an ln x instead of a regular x but don't care that much. So that's kind of a proof along those lines. So what that means is over here, if we have a situation where we have one real solution with a multiplicity of two, then what we're going to do, and that was silly, I just have to move this down. Can I do that? I can't. Look at me doing stuff. Whoa, that was crazy. Okay, I am good at computers. All right, so if we have a situation, we have one real solution with a multiplicity of two, then what we're gonna do is we're gonna guess that y is equal to c1 plus c2 natural log of x times x to the r. And maybe without too much loss of generality, we can again think about, okay, well, how would we have done this for the two complex solutions situation? So before, when we had two complex solutions, we said that we had e to the minus alpha t times the cosine, or c1, sorry, times c1 cosine beta, I'm not sure why I'm saying t all of a sudden, x cosine beta x plus c2 sine beta x, along those lines. And actually, we've got something very, very similar for what we have here, because in this case, again, if we kind of go off to the side and remember that our little x tilde here is actually equal to the natural log of x, then what we see is if I make that substitution, I have e negative alpha natural log of x, c1, and I'm going to write off the page, and then I move over so you can see what I'm doing, and c2 sine natural log of x, like that. Okay, so if I have e to the negative alpha natural log of x, that's the same thing as saying e to the natural log of x to the negative alpha power, which is of course the same thing as x to the negative alpha c1 cosine beta ln x plus c2 sine beta ln x. And again, this isn't like a proof that you could go tell a math teacher and they'd be like, you're such a genius. It's more of a, you know, engineering approach of, you know, I can mess some stuff around and yeah, I can kind of get where that comes from. So that's really all I'm trying to show you, is just a little bit of a hint of where that comes from. So basically, to fill out this table, because we don't want this anymore, is we can say that if we have a solution, we have two complex solutions for the Euler equation, then our final answer is going to come in the term x to the negative alpha times, why did I say negative? I just threw a negative in there for absolutely no reason. I apologize, there wasn't supposed to be a negative because there's not a negative here, I was just being weird. All right, x to the alpha and then c1 cosine beta ln x and then c2 sine beta ln x. So this is just another basic way to approach solving some diffie Qs, and Euler equations are a good one a good one to get started with. So it's just like everything else that you've probably been doing in DiffyQ thus far. It's just a little bit weird because you have these little natural loggy thingies that are popping up for no particular reason.